very pleased to be here, and I'm thankful to the organizers. I'm a little bit disappointed about that I wasn't able to come at least a week earlier, 2 weeks earlier to attend the school as well. I noticed that especially the young people have been enjoying the full scale of the school and meeting as well. So what I'm going to, can you hear me? Okay. So what I'm going to talk about, not yet. Which one is the pager? Yes, that's the laser and that's the pager. Yes, that's my plan. The big issue is why we think Newtonian quantum gravity is important. Then I introduce the notion of spatial mass density, which is the key ingredient of Newtonian quantum gravitational models. Then I come to standard Schrödinger equation with Newton Newton gravity as a perpetual. This is standard quantum gravity. Despite my chosen address, this is standard unaltered unitary quantum mechanics. Now, in mid-1980s, the first robust modification, surviving modification of standard quantum mechanics was born in terms of the Schrödinger-Newton equation. And I will come to a parameter, omega g, which plays a crucial role in all Newtonian modifications of quantum mechanics. Then I come to talk about the gravity-related spontaneous decoherence model, the DP model, where P is Penrose, and it's not my credit that I chose this order between the two. Then some interesting, very fresh developments that I will report from a byproduct of the ELISA Pathfinder experiment this year. A kind of sort of digression to see how educated colleagues, educated quantum cosmologists and field theorists attacked the same problem that our community is interested in. It's rarely ever quoted series of articles, three of them. And then I come to the latest theoretical refinement, which was done by Antoine Tilloy and myself this year. We published it this year. And then I come to the summary. So why just Newtonian quantum gravity? What is the my usual exposition of the issue is the following. I ask question, what is the bottleneck, what is the main obstacle of having a good and consistent quantum gravity theory? For the mainstream, this is just, okay? This is why mainstream theoreticians try to use different, better and better ways to quantize general relativity, to quantize the three geometry representation, canonical representation of Einstein's theory, to quantize in loop or string representations. Now, this is mainstream. But after the 1980s, some people recognized that it may be or even must be quantum, which is the bottleneck. Then we must turn toward issues of quantum mechanics, namely Schrödinger cat, the existence of Schrödinger cats, and problematic theory of quantum measurement and wave function collapse. If they are the bottleneck, then since they are typical non-relativistic issues like Schrödinger cat or wave function collapse, even if the latter has serious conflicts with relativity. But if we realize that the Schrödinger cat and measurement problem are typical non-relativistic issues, then it deserves to go non-relativistic first, to try to settle the issue, the conflict between gravity and quantization at the non-relativistic level. And the hope is that some new quantum mechanics may come from the so-called Newtonian quantum gravity, which is just the non-relativistic projection of the not yet existing relativistic quantum gravity. So we go here, and this is what we are talking about right now. Now, we need introducing the key quantity for Newtonian gravity, quantized or unquantized, and that's the special mass density rho of air and the special resolution sigma. So, as I suggested, let's forget full energy momentum dAB and use only its upper left corner, T naught naught over C squared, and in the non-relativistic limit, that's our non-relativistic spatial mass distribution, rho with the hat at location r. If we have components labeled by k, then the elementary expression of this very important and central quantity, central object, is given here, where this delta with sigma stands for a sigma smeared delta function, actually a Gaussian of a standard width sigma. Xk are the quantized coordinates of the k's material components. If you are a big face, you may introduce the same quantity in second quantized non-relativistic representation using Fock absorption and creation operators, but the result is the same. I prefer this elementary form, but it is equivalent with the second quantized expression of mass density in space. Now, the first physical issue: what are the sources of gravity? If the sources are the nuclei, or whether the sources are just bulk matter. Accordingly, if the sources are individual nuclei, then the mass, the spatial resolution, sigma, must be set to somewhere about the nuclear size, 10 to the minus 12 centimeter. On the contrary, if gravity is not that sensitive to the details, to the subatomic details, at the other extreme, we have to set sigma about 10 to the minus 5 centimeters, meaning that the source of Newtonian gravity is bulk matter. Gravity does not see the atomic or subatomic details. Now, observe that there is no evidence so far. Which extreme must be our choice? So this issue of spatial resolution measured by sigma is a burning and lasting issue, as we shall see. Now that's standard Schrödinger equation with Newton gravity. I couldn't insert any time, 1932 or 1952, whatever, because I never noticed any publication which considered Schrödinger quantum mechanics plus Newtonian pair potentials. This is standard quantum mechanics, and you see here I introduced spatial mass density of resolution sigma, which is not written here, but it is understood that rho resolves the spatial density up to sigma and not back. No. The only justification of this equation is that it has the suitable classical limit. So it yields Newton gravity for you, for the apple or for the plumbum block. In quantum regime, tests are currently impossible because the gravitational interaction is too small and only massive degrees of freedom could be influenced. Now, with massive degrees of freedom, we are not yet able to do quantum mechanics because they are subject of decoherence, immediate environmental decoherence. The situation can change or may change within years or decades or 50 years, but this is the sad situation today. So the issue is open, what the resolution is. It is this one, nuclear size, or 12 order, or 7 orders of magnitude bigger, 10 to minus 5 centimeters. Unfortunately, the classical limit of this standard Schrödinger equation with Newton pair potential, this is not sensitive to resolution sigma. And quantum tests are missing, as I said. Therefore, we are free to speculate. We are free to alter quantum mechanics. And fortunately or unfortunately, we have to and we are free to choose sigma. Okay, this is, as I said, the first surviving robust non-standard modification of quantum of the Schrödinger equation related to Newtonian gravity. It's from 1984. I mean, the foundation of the equation had been known before, but its foundational role was suggested in 1984 only. So let me show you the standard, the previous slide. Okay, the formal change is that here I replace this quantized mass density by its expectation value in the given quantum state psi. Okay, let's page now. Okay, and you see it's here. Equation is the same, but this time with the expectation value. So this introduces non-linearity of the equation. And this non-linearity generates self-interaction. It means that even for a single particle, you get a Newtonian self-interaction, which is not the case with the pair potential. If you apply the standard pair potential to a single particle situation, there is no interaction, no Newtonian force at all. So this nonlinearity introduces self-interaction. If I have a bulk, larger composite object with center of mass quantized coordinate x, and if the quantum mass uncertainty of the center of mass x is much smaller than the resolution sigma of my mass density, then I get this equation. This is much simpler than the upper one. And as you see, the Schrödinger-Newton interaction generates kind of harmonic oscillator potential to confine the wave function around around the expectation value of x. So this is still a nonlinear equation, but this form can be easily solved for its ground states. And the minimum energy states are solitons, localized stationary states, meaning that for bulk bodies, center of mass of them, the ground states are localized solitary states, which is great. We like it because, on the contrary, we have never accepted that center of mass of bulk bodies could express large spatial distributions. Now we have localized stationary states for them. But we don't have decoherence. This is a deterministic equation, so it cannot describe decoherence. Although some people speculate that non-linearity might mean chaos, chaotic behavior, and maybe some effective decoherence generates from this equation alone. I wouldn't say yes or no. Maybe, but typically this equation, since it is deterministic and reversible, it cannot generate decoherence, neither wave function collapse. I must add to the story of this equation, to the later developments, that some friends and colleagues thought that the originators of
the foundational application of the Newton-Schrödinger equation, wanted to derive the coherence or collapse from that equation. To myself, I never wanted. I was always sure that since, as I said, the equation was deterministic and reversible, it had nothing to do with the coherence or wave function collapse. Now again, we see that the localization will heavily depend on gravity spatial resolution sigma. Look at this quantity omega g, which it looks like an oscillator frequency here, and it generates localization, it generates the solitonic solutions. Actually, you can, without paper and pen, you can guess what the solitonic state must be. Because this Hamiltonian is a harmonic oscillator. So you can solve it easily, okay, for the ground state. Now, let's see the values of this wave function confining quantity or parameter in the two extreme cases. In the nuclear size resolution, this frequency is about 1 kilohertz. At the other extreme, it's 1 millihertz. So the difference is huge. And we must love the strong edge value because it can be falsified or confirmed in the near future. Yes. The other extreme of bulk resolution, 10 to minus 5 centimeter, is apparently hopeless as for its experimental testability. Let me talk about this parameter omega g, which I derive as the frequency of a classical so-called Newton oscillator. After 2013, some literature called it the Schrödinger Newton frequency. I don't agree with it. However, it is relevant for the Schrödinger-Newton equation for the center of mass confining harmonic potential, but it is fully quantum. It's very easy to interpret it. Consider a homogeneous ball, macroscopic ball, say, or whatever, of density rho. I should have written rho naught because in the mathematical part I use rho naught for the same quantity. So I have a homogeneous ball. I make a diametral tunnel through it, place a test body in it, push it slightly. It's well known from maybe secondary school or first year university studies, that the potential is harmonic, so you get a harmonic oscillator. The frequency is omega g. That's omega g. That's completely classical. Now, omega g depends on rho naught. If I'm in nuclear matter, or I am in common matter of water density, then there is a 1 million factor in favor of nuclear matter. Now, it happens in Newton-Schrödinger equation that depending on the resolution sigma, omega g becomes equivalent with the Newton oscillator frequency in nuclear matter if the resolution is the nuclear size, or in common matter if the resolution is 10 to the minus 5 centimeters. So remember, Newtonian self-interaction for the center of mass of a bulk looked like this with the omega. And it's almost frightening that, frightening because we don't know what sigma we should use. But depending on our choice, the strength of this potential, this harmonic potential, can change over 12 orders of magnitude. For nuclear size resolution, this confining potential and the Newton-Schrödinger self-interaction is 10 to the 12 times stronger. And we have no handle yet to guess which one is closer to reality. When did I start? Okay. Now, I was complaining that Schrödinger Newton was not for decoherence, was not for collapse, was not to kill Schrödinger cats if they had ever been created. There is a gravity-related theory of spontaneous decoherence from 1987 first, which can kill Schrödinger cats, the theory's main role is to decohere massive microscopic superpositions, spatial superpositions. And the term which does it for us is written here. Now, this double commutator structure is well known. 20 or 30 years ago, it was not that typical. It has become typical to describe any simple decoherence effects. Now, it is quite a familiar structure for a larger and larger community of young scientists. Again, the structure becomes much simpler if we consider some bulk matter, maybe a ball, a rigid ball, with center of mass coordinate x with the hat. And again, we assume that the coherent width of the center of mass is much less than the yet unknown resolution sigma. We got this equation. It is quite similar to the Schrödinger-Newton equation with the harmonic potential. But in place of harmonic potential, now we have the double commutator. Yeah, we do it. My last but one slide is about that. Okay, the role of the same omega g has now changed. It's the decoherence rate. I will discuss its values again later at bottom of the slide. But there is a typical, apparently unavoidable problem with all spontaneous decoherence for collapse theories, and this is universal heating. It is not accidental. Typical collapse, standard collapse, will violate conservation rules. Now, spontaneous collapse or spontaneous decoherence is nothing else than the same thing as the regular standard textbook collapse. But it is spontaneous. It doesn't require a measurement device. It is just postulated. But accordingly, it will not preserve energy or momentum. Spontaneous collapse and decoherence theories violate conservation rules. And the saddest part of it, that they will universally heat up all degrees of freedom. And the heating rate per 1 degree of freedom is written here. It is again parameterized by this omega g. It means that the heating rate, that a heating occurs to each degree of freedom by half of the Planck quantum, h bar omega g, with the frequency omega g. This is the heating rate per degree of freedom. Now, here I come to the table. This part is the old one. Now, omega g is the decoherence rate. As before, it is 1 kilohertz for the fine resolution. It is 1 millihertz for bulk matter, bulk resolution. And the heating rate is 10 to the minus 21 erg per second per degree of freedom for fine resolution. It is much, much, much smaller if the resolution is worsened. Now, at the strong effect edge, which I mean, which means this part, when I have very, very fine resolutions. I call it strong effect edge. The heating is 10 microkelvin per second. That seems much too high. Can it be ruled out some way? And this is where the very, very new LISA Pathfinder experiment comes into the story. LISA Pathfinder is a preparatory experiment to a million kilometer baseline gravity wave detector in space. The Pathfinder places two microscope object, 2 kilograms each, some 30 centimeters away from each other in space, where they are levitated under perfect control. This is the best ever control over the center of mass of a microscopic body. Here is their number. They can control the relative acceleration noise between the two 4 centimeter cubes, 30 centimeters away from each other. They can control the relative acceleration noise at 5 femtometers per square second over square root of Hertz in a narrow but very relevant range of frequencies, very low frequencies, from 0.7 to 20 millihertz. It means a bunch of seconds and minutes. And this is the most direct test of spontaneous decurrence. It seems to rule out the DP stronger edge version, this one, because, as I said, at this, I call it strong edge, DP would heat each degree of freedom by 10 to the minus 21 Earth per second. And Helu, Slagmull, and McClelland, and Yanbei Chen, this year, right after the LIGHTER PASS when they published its first result, they pointed out that LIGHTER results suggest that sigma cannot be smaller than 4 times 10 to the minus 25 centimeters. And LISA will improve on, the, on its data, so we expect that the strong edge resolution, 10 to minus 12 centimeter, is going to be ruled out near future, if it is not already ruled out by the fresh data. Two and a half minutes. Oh, I'm sorry. So this is the story of starting with Hawking's proposal that space-time fluctuations, instantons, and Planck scale will destroy the unitarity of universal evolution. And he introduced non-unitary superscattering operator, which cannot be represented by the unitary ones. Banks, Susskind, and Paskin immediately showed that there is a possible master equation to realize Hawking's concept. And they proposed this master equation in 49. And this master equation looks very similar to my master equation, which I proposed independently and unaware of BSP results. Simply, I gave a concrete representation to the fields that they did not really specify. What is even more important, that Resnick and Oppenheim considered a possible revision of this mechanism in order to conserve at least the total momentum. And they suggested, they never published it. I think they couldn't get a perfect conclusion. So they suggested that relational variables might be decohered, and then the total, at least the total momentum, total energy can be preserved. This is a slide of modification which was online proposed by TP. When we put semi-classical gravity and DP collapse together, I think that Antoine will report on that. Okay, and that's my last slide. As I said, sorry for running out of time. I'm very sorry. I emphasize that there is standard quantum mechanics with pair potentials. the effect is too small and far from testability. I argued why we should or may or might consider non-standard Newton gravity theories, Schrödinger Newton, gravity-related decoherence, and so on. The new effects depend heavily on sigma in the strong effect regime. The Newton-Schrödinger self-interaction or deep heating become testable in coming years. So if Schrödinger gets a bottleneck of quantum gravity, then Newton quantum gravity might be the key for us that we are looking for. The proposed theories are still incomplete. They are not fully consistent, but they can yet encode a piece of truth. Experiments will decide in the coming years if Newton and quantum gravity concerns new physics at all. Experiments, I must add orally, that some smart future refinements of the already proposed theories. Thank you very much. I'm sorry for
questions.
Could you explain this Lisa Pathfinder experiment? How can they measure a heating by leaving fall 2 kilogram mass in the satellite? It's not clear for me.
They didn't look for heating. They were looking for relative acceleration of, imagine, one little cube, nearly that size, gold, platinum, the other one, and in space, levitating and controlled by optical and electrostatic sensors and manipulators. And they can ensure that the noise in relative acceleration of the two macroscopic bodies cannot be higher than the very, very, very minuscule quantity. And if deep decoherence had the finest resolution, 10 to the minus 12 centimeters, meaning the strongest predicted effect, then they, these effects, this heating, is already ruled out by the limit on the relative acceleration put by Lisa Pathfinder first data.
You mentioned this argument by Banks, Peskin, and Soskin, I think. And if I remember, they argued that the violations of energy momentum conservation would be far too large and would be ruled out completely. But then there was this argument by Wald and Unruh that supposedly criticized their estimates. Do you know what is the status of that?
I know that the
debate.
Nearly the same year, Bill Unruh, maybe with Wald, Bob Wald, published some further discussions on a possible conservation of energy and momentum. I think that their conclusion was that either in this non-Newton models, either we retain locality or we retain momentum and energy conservation. The two cannot be done together. So these people, ironically, I call them educated people in mainstream quantum cosmology and mainstream field theory and mainstream general relativity. For those people, the concept that there is some formal universal difference in nature was delegitimated by just by the effect which we call heating in our models. So these people never returned to the concept of Hawking. Let's assume some, or let's derive some difference from first principles of quantum mechanics, because they recognized that there was an unavoidable violation of conservation rules. I mean, there was heating. It doesn't mean that they delegitimated our spontaneous models at the same time. Simply, we must be aware of the experience of those of that other community, the community of real quantum cosmologists.
Can gravitational fluctuations be the fundamental source of stochasticity in collapse models? What's your thinking, Karan?
Formally, the dp difference can be underlined by gravitational fluctuations, formally. So I must say that the master equation I introduced in my talk, the master equation is equivalent to the assumption of background fluctuations of the space-time. I'm talking about phenomenologically postulated background fluctuations. I guess that what you are talking, you are suggesting, is something different. You are talking about more or less standard quantum fluctuations of background space-time, which you can derive from this not yet fully consistent field theories of gravity. No, they don't. If I would dream of decurrence caused by vacuum quantum fluctuations of the space-time, I would get into conceptual conflict with the notion of quantized vacuum. It cannot, a vacuum state cannot generate decurrence.
Sorry to interrupt, but we can have more discussion over tea.